This morning, we're going to go back to our series on the Beatitudes. And so if you would turn in your Bibles to Matthew 5, and we'll continue on. We have covered already, blessed are those who are poor in spirit, those who mourn, those who are meek, those who hunger and thirst, and those who are merciful. We have covered those, and today we're going to be looking at the fifth beatitude, which is blessed are the pure in heart. And so we're going to be looking at that verse, but if you would turn also in Mark 7, I'm going to be reading verses 14 through 23, along with the beatitude in Mark 5, verse 8. And would you please, if you are able, stand as we hear God's word spoken to us this morning. Hear these words from the Lord from Matthew 5, verse 8. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. And then from Mark 7, beginning at verse 14, hear these words from the Lord. Again, Jesus called the crowd to him, and he said, "Listen to me, everyone, and understand this. Nothing outside a man can make him unclean by going into him. Rather, it is what comes out of a man that makes him unclean." After he had left the crowd and entered the house, his disciples asked him about this parable. "Are you so dull?" he asked. "Don't you see that nothing that enters a man from the outside can make him unclean? For it doesn't go into his heart, but rather it goes into his stomach and then out of his body." In saying this, Jesus declared that all foods were clean. He went on and said, "What comes out of a man is what makes him unclean. For from within, out of man's heart, comes evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All of these evils come from inside, and they make a man unclean." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. The heart of the matter, that's what makes all the difference in life, in business, in sports. It can be the difference between success and failure. It can be the difference between winning and losing. Now, some of you can maybe relate to this example, this story that I'm going to share with you. Parent number one, when he was in high school and college, was an excellent baseball player. He excelled in baseball. He loved baseball. It was his passion. Parent number one had a son. And it was time for son to begin to learn about baseball. And so it was no more just hitting balls in the backyard and playing catch in the backyard. It was time to actually play in a team. And so he signed him up. The son had some talent. Came from his father, of course. And he understood the game because he'd heard his dad talking about it for years. And so the son went and played baseball. He tried. He tried. But he just didn't love it. He just didn't care for it. And so eventually he dropped baseball because he didn't have a passion. His heart was not in it. He didn't have a heart or a passion for the game. And so he didn't really want to try. He didn't want to really put all his energy into it. Now, we know what that's like. But in our Christian life, for us as Christians, we claim that Jesus is the one that we follow. We claim that Jesus is the one that has our heart. He has paid for us. He has died for us. He is our Savior and the one that we serve as a master. But is that where our heart is at? Is that where our passion comes from? Jesus said these words, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moths and rust will decay and thieves will break in and steal. But rather store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moth and rust will not decay and where thieves cannot break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart is also. So the question we have to ask ourselves is, what is our treasure? What are the things that we hold dear and near to our heart and are most important for us? Are they earthly things? Oh, we can treasure earthly things. We can take pride in earthly things. We can have a passion for earthly things. But our first and foremost passion and treasure must be Jesus. And so he says, store up for yourselves treasures in heaven. For where your treasure is, that is where your heart is also. But as we've read in the passage of Mark, there's another side to this story. Jesus told his disciples that it wasn't the food that they ate or the things that they put in their body that caused unclean things to come out, but rather unclean things, evil things, sinful things that he listed come out of our bodies, come out of our mouths, come out of our hands and our feet and the things that we do because our hearts are evil. Our hearts are evil. They're filled with evil intent. And they, our heart desires to feed the passion that it has for evil. But Jesus also said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. How is this possible? We have evil hearts, but Jesus says we are blessed when we have a pure heart and that we will see God. First of all, a pure heart seems impossible, right? Because the Bible says our hearts are evil. And then, how can we see God? The Bible says that no man can see God because if he sees God through his face and his face comes face to face with God, he will not be able to live. Moses, in Exodus 33, Moses has come down from the mountain with the Ten Commandments, and you remember the story, and the golden calf, and he throws the tablets down, and so now he has to go back up to the mountain. And he stands before God, and he asks him if he can see his presence, if he can see his glory. Because, you know, he's just had the wind taken out of his sails a little bit, because the people, when he came down from the mountain, weren't in this place that he wanted them to be. And so he asked God if he could see his glory, and God allows him to see his glory. But he tucks him in a crack in the rock. It's called the cleft of the rock. And as God passes by, Moses is able to see his glory as he is leaving. He's able to see his afterglow because that's all that Moses can handle. Moses wasn't able to stand face to face before God and see him. The cloud covered God, hid him. He could hear his voice, but he could not see him. But he was able to see the afterglow, and as he comes down from the mountain, his face is still filled with the glory. It glows because of God's glory. And so all of us desire to see God. All of us should desire to have a pure heart. But how is this possible? First of all, the pure heart. When Matthew is talking about blessed are those who are pure in heart, when we think about a pure heart, what we should not think about is a heart that is void and free of sin. That the only way we can have a pure heart is, the only way that this happens, that we are able to see God, is if our heart is totally pure and sinless. That's not what God is talking about. This is not what is happening here, because if we were to think that way in our life, if I were to think that way in my life, I would have abandoned my faith long ago. Because the harder I try to be pure, the harder I try to be without sin, the more I realize and see that there is sin in my life. It's sort of like when you're cleaning or vacuuming or picking up. You pick up and you pick up, and then pretty soon you think you're done and you look, oh, you forgot. Oh, there's something over there. And there, oh, there's something over there. And you see sin everywhere in your life. And just like cleaning up behind kids and cows, you clean it up one day, you go back the next day, doesn't look like you did anything. You've got to clean up again. That's the way it is with our life. And so it's not being without sin. There are three sense of purity and holiness. The first one is God is holy, and we heard about that when the angel talked about when Isaiah, in the year of King Uzziah, saw the temple filled with his glory, with the smoke, and the angels, that angels even had to cover their faces. They said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. God alone is holy. Then there's the holiness, the purity that we are going to experience when we come into God's presence in eternity, when Jesus comes again. And the Bible says then we will be like him. We will be holy and pure, without sin, like him. But until that day comes, we're going to be fighting against sin. And so we will not be able to be holy and pure as God is holy. But God is calling us to pursue holiness, to seek holiness, to desire to be more holy. We are called to pursue, to seek God's holiness. Now, in order to do that, we need to have an undivided heart. We need to have our heart's attention and focus to be on God, to be on who God is. And when we see who God is, we acknowledge his glory and his holiness, and we worship and praise him. We have to want to see who God is. We have to want to know what God desires of us, and we have to desire to honor and serve him in all that we do. Too often we say we love Jesus. We say that we want to walk with him. We say that we want to serve him. But then our friend calls. Our friend taps us on the shoulder. Satan taps us on the shoulder and says, hey, have you heard about this? Have you ever done that? Do you realize that this is going on? You need to help me over. You need to do something over here. And he draws us away and he distracts us. Too often we as Christians say that we serve God and serve him alone, because it's the right thing to say. Yeah, we love Jesus. But then, when we live our lives, people can see what we really love, what really is important, where the treasure of our heart is. We love this world. We love the things that this world has to offer. And we will bend over backwards and we'll do anything to experience and participate in the things of the world. We say we want to serve God, but in practice we serve the world. When Elijah gathered the Israelites on Mount Carmel, the story of Mount Carmel where the fire came down and it was time of a, and then the rain came and quenched the fire. Elijah said to the people of Israel, why do you go limping around? Why is it that you go limping around between two opinions? If you want to serve Baal, serve him. If you want to serve God, serve him. But you can't serve both. You have to have this undivided attention of your heart. Now, just to affirm in us that being pure is not being sinless, we have to remember the person of David. David is a person in the Bible that is referred to as a man after God's own heart. We hear it. We see it. But we also remember that David was a murderer, that David was an adulterer. David was not without sin. There was sin, terrible sin that happened in his life. But he was a man after God's own heart because he sought, he desired, he pursued God, even though he was sinful. In Psalm 86, he writes these words, "Teach me your way, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart that I may fear your name." So it requires an undivided heart. A pure heart needs to be undivided, one that seeks God. A purifying of our heart is not a heart that is without sin. The purity of our heart is determined by who we are pursuing. And so let's look at that heart that we looked at and heard about in Mark, where it said the heart is filled with evil and sinful desires. How do we make that heart one that desires God rather than desiring evil? How do we make that heart one that's turning toward God with undivided attention rather than saying it wants to follow God, but really it follows the world and sin? Now, this is made possible by God. The heart is able to change its desire only by God's work. And the first thing that happens is forgiveness. Forgiveness for sin. Because we have sin in our life, we find forgiveness when we ask for it. When we put our faith in Jesus, when we trust that His death and shed blood take our sins away, that He reconciles Himself to us. You see, our eternal hope, I would trust that all of us have eternal hope. Eternal hope that someday our lives will be free of sin. That one day we will be able to spend our time in God's presence, before His face, before His throne, and everything will be perfect and renewed and made new again. That's our eternal hope. But our eternal hope does not depend on or rest on our perfect deeds. It does not depend on us being without sin. It depends on us trusting in God, putting faith in Jesus and His work of atonement, so that when we stand before our Maker, the sins that we have committed, God does not charge us. He doesn't charge us. He doesn't say, "You're guilty." He says to Jesus, "You are the one that is taking on this sin. I charge you and I condemn you. You have died on the cross. You have paid for this sin." And so we are free from the charge, free from the guilt, free from the penalty and the debt that is owed. Jesus has paid it all. But not only does He forgive us, He also cleanses us. He cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Those He forgives, He also cleanses. We read in Scripture, "He washes me and I shall be white as snow." Now, forgiveness may seem easy compared to cleansing and making pure. We have to turn to God. We have to repent and we have to have faith, and our sins are forgiven. It's as simple as that. Repent of your sins. Be sorry for your sins and they are forgiven. But the cleansing part involves more work. God does the forgiving. And there's nothing we can do other than repent and ask for forgiveness. And God grants it. But cleansing requires us to participate. Cleansing, making our hearts pure, requires for us to pursue, to seek, to desire God in our life. Now, we don't do that alone. God helps us, but we need to participate. Like Paul, we remember that the things that we want to do, or the things that we should do, or the things that we should not do are the things that we do, and the things that we should do are the things that we do not do. In other words, we should be doing right and we're doing wrong. And instead of doing wrong, we should be doing right. But it doesn't work that way because we're sinful. But God says also, Paul also says, that we are to press on. One thing I do, Paul says, I press on in faith. I persevere. I cross the finish line. I seek to find God. And so the cleansing requires us to be in faith and to press on, to fight, to watch, to pray, to ask, to seek, to persevere, to strive. Our son had ADD. Had a terrible time focusing his attention on anything, on schoolwork, on tasks. Could not focus. And it was causing him difficulties in life and in school. And so at a young age, we went and sought some help, and the doctor prescribed some medicine, small dosage, to try to help him focus and concentrate. But the doctor said, now don't use this ADD as an excuse. Just because you have this doesn't mean that you can just use that for an excuse every time and say, well, I didn't get that job done because I have ADD. Oh, I didn't get that homework assignment done. I have ADD. Don't use it for an excuse. You have to focus. You have to try. The medicine will hopefully help you. God will help us have an undivided heart, but we have to also apply some effort. We also have to do some work. The Spirit will help us, but we have to do some work. Blessed are those who are pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are those who seek and desire God so that He can cleanse and make their hearts pure. So what do we do? What is it that we can do? The heart of the matter is we have an evil heart that needs to be purified. How do we take care of the matter? The first thing we have to do is believe. Believe that God can cleanse our heart. Believe that even though we look at our lives and we see that sin is pervasive, that as hard as we try, sin still shows up. It rears its ugly head time and time again. We have to believe that God can cleanse us of that sin and make our hearts pure. We have to believe that God is able to do that. And in order to believe that God is able to do that, we have to want God to do that. So believe. God not only forgives, but He cleanses us. He makes our hearts pure. He removes sin from us. Another thing is that we need to do is we need to confess. Remember the first Beatitudes, blessed are the broken spirit. Confess. Acknowledge the sin in your life. Name it. Name it. Specifically, what is the greatest challenge? The sin that always seem to be tripping over. Name it, confess it, and ask God to take it away from you. Then the third thing is listen. Listen. How do we listen to what God has to say to us? God says, I will cleanse your heart. I will forgive you and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. Listen to what God has to say. Immerse yourself in God's word. Allow yourselves to soak in it. You know, because it's hard for us to take a heart of stone that is entrenched in sinfulness and wickedness, that is evil to the core, and to make it clean and pure, to make it a heart of flesh. Sort of like when I was farming and you went and you had to take a piece of machinery apart, and it was probably the spreader. And you had to take it apart to fix it, and the bolts were all rusted. And if you took a wrench to it, you were going to break everything. And so you go and get the WD-40 or the other stuff that penetrating oil that penetrates the rust and removes the rust, but then you still have to take the wrench. And if you put a little pressure along on it, pretty soon that nut turns off the bolt. When we immerse ourselves in God's Word, that sin that has held us tightly is able to be loosened. And we are able to actually turn in the direction of God and seek to do His will instead of our own will. The thing that holds us has been broken. And so immerse yourself in God's Word. Let it soak. Let yourself soak in it. The fourth thing is worship. Worship God. Gaze upon God. Gaze upon His glory. Gaze upon His beauty. The Bible says that we become what we behold. We become what we behold. And it's true. It's true. Look at your children. How many of them act like you, talk like you, look like you? Why is that? Some of it's genetic, but some of it is they have beholden you. They have watched you. They have looked at you from the time that they were able to watch when they were little, and they have observed, and they become like you. When we look at God, when we behold Him, and we gaze upon Him, we become like Him. We want to become like Him. But we have to look at Him. We have to worship Him. Now, an undivided heart desires to serve God. So it means that it is our passion and our desire is to hear God speak to us, spend time with Him in prayer, in Scripture, and in worship. Now that means that we have a passion. God wants us to have a passion and a desire to spend time with Him every day in His Word, to pray with Him every day. And when we have this opportunity to worship, to come into His presence with God's people, why would we skip it? Unless we have an undivided heart. Unless we have a divided heart. One that says, yes, I love God, but I also love these other things. Yes, I want to serve God, but yes, I'm also serving other things. When we have a heart that's undivided, we will want to worship. We will want to spend time in His Word. We will want to spend time in prayer each and every day, because without it, we cannot survive. And we will want to gather for worship every opportunity we have. That's when we know our heart is not divided. We will also ask. We will pray and ask that God would give us a clean heart. Purify my heart, O God, and let no wicked way remain within me, is the prayer that David writes in the Psalm. Ask. Ask that God would purify your heart, that He would cleanse you and make you clean. And then we have to persevere, because it's not going to be easy. I'm thinking about Caitlin and Jessica, and they have graduated. It's been 12 years of school, and as they look back on those 12 years, there have been some really good times, lots of fun, and there have been some really hard times. Some days when they came home crying from school, probably. Some days where they didn't want to go to school because they didn't want to face what they had to face. Lots of difficulties. in those 12 years. And the reality is that life is going to be much the same. Their life after graduation, their future, although they dream of making it so that none of those things happen, we've all had those dreams, but we know that that's not reality. We have difficulties that we face. And Paul spiritually also faced difficulties, and he said we must persevere. He says, one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining toward what's ahead, I press on towards the goal in order to win the prize. Keep your eyes on the prize. Keep your eyes focused on what is important. What is the treasure of your heart? Where's the direction of your heart going? The eyes of your heart, once your heart gets more purified, are able to see more clearly and less divided, and we will see more clearly where we should be. And finally, the last thing, after believing, confessing, listening, worshiping, asking, and persevering, is having an expectation. What is your expectation? What is your hope? What are you hoping for? My hope is that someday I will be with Him and I will be like Him. That I will be able to experience holiness and purity in the presence of God. But I have to work at it. I have to participate. I have to be engaged. We often think that innocence and purity is something that we have when we are young. We look at little ones and we think, oh, look at how innocent they are. Look at how beautiful and pure they are, babies, infants. And as children grow up, their innocence and their purity leaves, and they are no longer so innocent and pure. But the Bible says that innocence and purity becomes a greater part of who we are as we mature, as we grow in our faith. It's something to be gained as we grow, as we become older. As we seek God, as we look in His face, and as we mature in our faith, we will become more like Him, more pure, more innocent. And when we do that, the eyes of our heart are opened, and we are able to see God. Oftentimes I ask people to tell me experiences in their life throughout the week when they saw God. We say that God is with us everywhere we go, so we should be able to see God regularly. See God at work. See God doing something. We may not see God in person, but we can see the effect, the work of His hands in our life. That tells us that God was here. Oftentimes when I ask, they're like, I have to think about that. Can I get back to you later? When our hearts are made pure, when God is doing the work of purifying and cleansing our hearts, when we have an undivided heart and a singular focus on God, we are able to see Him more clearly. We will see Him when we read His Word. We'll understand. We'll say, oh my goodness, thank you, God, for showing me this today. We will see Him in prayer. We'll say, God, you spoke to me exactly in the place that I needed to be spoken to you. I have that all the time. Just the other day, I was wallowing in my pity, feeling sorry for myself. And I turned to Scripture in the devotional that I had for the day, and it spoke directly to that part of my life. That we are going to have bad days, that we are going to have difficulties, but do not lose sight of the One who has given you life. And so in prayer, you'll see God more clearly. You'll see God in worship. Now, I know. People come to church and they worship and they go through all, they sing the songs, they pray the prayers, they bring their offerings, they bring more offerings. They come, they try to listen, and they go home and it's like, I wish I could be blessed. I wish I could enjoy it. I wish I could find joy in it. The fact is that their heart is not allowing them. Their heart is not being made pure. They need to ask. They need to prepare. But when we do that, when we come into worship, we will see God more clearly. We'll see God in our trials. We'll see God in our triumphs. We'll see God in His people, and we won't grumble and complain about our neighbor. We love our church. But do you know? Did you hear about that? That just burns me. We won't be that way. We'll be gracious. We'll see God in people, in our people. We'll love them in the way that God wants to love them. We'll see God in His church. And if we see God in His church, if we see God in His people, if our heart is being made pure and we desire and seek God in all that we do, we see God, others will see God in us. Others will look at us and say, "You're a Christian, aren't you? You're a Christian. I can see it. And thank you for letting me see it." And maybe they'll ask, "How can I have this? Same thing. Because I see the joy in your face. I hear the happiness in your voice. I hear the pleasantness. I see you are pleasant to be around. When I'm around you, I just feel better about myself. Not worse." Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. And others also will see God.